already being quiet, so that must mean it's time to begin, which is great. I want to welcome you to the second of the President's Leadership Lecture Series this fall at the University of the Fraser Valley. My name is Peter Geller, and I'm the Vice Provost and Associate Vice President Academic, and I'd like to welcome you all here. It's my pleasure to be the MC for this evening. And so I'm going to, what we're going to do is first I will introduce our UFV Elder in Residence, Titlin Sath, Eddie Gardner, who will bring us a formal welcome.
My dear ones, my name is Aitlam Spat, means Saint Bear. I guess I better sing you a song. And I come from the Squaw First Nation, and it gives me great pleasure to give you a very warm welcome to the unceded territory, the Squaw people. We've lived in this territory for thousands of years. Some archaeologists say 9,000. It's very good to see some of our Skalo people here. as a people of the river, we have a very strong connection to our relatives we call the salmon. And this is our cedar hats we wear. It comes from our tree of life. The Cree was an ancient long ago relative who was transformed into the cedar tree because of his generosity of spirit. And so when we look upon the landscape around us, our great transformer who moved through our territory left a legacy, not only a legacy of what happened long ago, but the teachings that come along with it about how we need to take care of one another, how we need to take care of our relatives in the natural world, how to live in harmony and peace. This is a very powerful and good vision. And when we walk through our territory and look at in the landscape, we are reminded of this beautiful code of conduct about how we need to live together. And so it is a great pleasure for me to be here with you this evening, welcoming a very special guest, George Littlechild, who will explain his, who will tell his story. And it's so good to see him here today, Dr. George Littlechild. Our president, Mark Everett with us, Eric Davis, Chancellor, our new Chancellor, Shishkowit, OCM, Glen Point, and welcome to each and every one of you. I'm going to sing a song. I usually sing a song from our territory, but this time I'm going to sing a song that will honor the Cree, the Ojibwe Cree. It's an Oji Cree song, and so it's to honor our guest here. The song is called a Spirit Bear Song, and the words that go to it generally kind of mean that the Spirit Bear is coming. The Spirit Bear is coming to bless the people. So this will be a special blessing to each and every one of you. We'll see.
And I want everybody to know that Eddie's wearing his new jacket.
Yeah, this is a pile of jacket. The pilot represents us as people of the river. So my wife made it not long ago, so I'm very happy to hear this.
And her name is Fran.
Her name is Fran.
Eddie's wife.
Fran. Call her Rainmaker. And some people say, oh, what a beautiful name, Rainmaker. Is that because she's so creative? And my wife, when she's around, she said, no, that's not why at all. She calls me Rainmaker because I rain on his parade all the time. Anyways, we're going to welcome our special guest, Osia. I just wanted to mention that I'm one of the two elders working here, Kumaga. Teresa Neal is also one of the elders who has been with this institution, this very fine institution, from its very roots. And she would have loved to be here today. And so it's on behalf of Kumaga and myself that we give you a very warm welcome to the University of the Fraser Valley as well. And here goes.
Tim Michelle and Demetrin. I'm just really happy to be here.
Thank you very much for welcoming us here, Eddie. And the reason that we're here, of course, is for a presentation from Dr. George Littlechild, who is the recipient of an honorary doctorate from the University of the Fraser Valley. And in a moment, I'll introduce our president, Dr. Mark Everett, to introduce George to us all. So after George's presentation, then there will be some time that we can have for some question and answer. We have both screens up, so really we welcome you into our Aboriginal gathering place. And I'm very pleased that everyone could make it. And I'll now call upon our president, Dr. Mark Everett, to say a few words of introduction.
I think you can hear me.
Yay!
I will set that aside. Thank you, Peter. Eddie, as usual, Kwasai. And OCM, Siaya, welcome to our gathering place. And it's my pleasure to introduce our very special guest, to welcome back our very special guest, Dr. George Littlechild, an alumnus of this university ever since he received a Doctor of Letters from us back in 2013. I'm going to use a few notes because this man's achievements exceed my memory bank, so I hope he'll excuse me. George is a member of the Plains Cree First Nation, born in Edmonton. But like so many young children in the 50s and 60s, he was taken from his home and into non-Aboriginal foster care, not reconnecting to his birth family until he was in his 20s. Unfortunately, both George's birth mother and father had died at that point, but he was able to connect through the many other relatives still present in that community. As we all know, far too common a story. But George found a very effective way to connect with his people, their culture, and their spirit through his art and through his storytelling. And we're all the beneficiaries. And because through his work, he's brought to the rest of us a better understanding, respect, celebration of the culture and the spirit, and created that spiritual guide and political drive for change in all of us, and we're greatly appreciative of that, George. In many respects, George's educational background exemplifies that of so many of our students here at the University of the Fraser Valley. He started out with a diploma in art and design from Red Deer College, and then from there went to a degree, as so many of our students do, from in a Bachelor of Fine Arts from the Nova Scotia College of it is called the College of Art and Design, still in Nova Scotia. And then in 1988, he completed independent studies at the Banff Centre. I know, a very prestigious place, a little difficult to get in, so congratulations. And you know, George, like so many of our students, has used his education, his talent, and his experience to benefit so many of the rest of us, benefiting other lives and other communities, both locally in his home community and very much well beyond, as I'll describe in a few moments. He's inspired so many of us to re-examine ourselves, our view of the world, and it rouses us to do a heck of a lot better. And what more could we ask? George, it's really an honor to be able to call you an alumnus of this university. Dr. Littlechild has produced hundreds of works of art, valued pieces in many public and private collections. I know there are people in this room who own pieces of art. Our Provost Eric Davis, as a gift to his wife Deanna, commissioned a piece. Deanna, I believe it's your cuckoo who's illustrated in this piece. And where did Dick Bates go? The Bates, Dick, former employee of this university, former senior administrator, and in fact, I think you were acting president for a while, weren't you, Dave? You didn't do that. I thought you did just about everything else. Benefactors, I just learned today that you own a piece of George Littlechild's art. George's exhibitions of his art, I did a quick count of the list, and I got up to 170 and I stopped. Must be getting pretty close to 200 exhibitions over the years, and of course he doesn't look old enough to have done that much. But that includes at least several dozen solo exhibitions and group exhibits in not only throughout Canada, throughout the United States, and Japan, Czechoslovakia, and Australia. So truly an artist of international renown. George, of course, is also very well known for the children's books that he's published. He's also created covers for books and for CDs, and been featured in countless newspaper and magazine articles and book reviews. He's taught at a number of schools, taught at Camosun College, Nicola Valley Institute of Technology, Emily Carr University of Art and Design, and the University of Calgary. Clearly a man of many, many talents. He's received numerous scholarships, grants, and awards. You can understand why we were humbled and honored to be able to offer this man an honorary degree. He's received the Aboriginal Role Models of Alberta Award, the Art Starts Award as an outstanding champion for the arts in BC schools and communities, the Visual Arts Department Award, BC Cultural Services Award, the Jane Addams Children's Book Award for his book This Land Is My Land, Canadian Children's Book Centre Award for What's the Beautiful Thing You Know About Horses, and the National Parenting Publications Gold Medal. George says in his artist statement on his website, "If I were asked what kind of art I create, I would answer by saying it is the art that speaks from the heart, the social, and the political." And we're going to hear some fine words illustrating that point here this afternoon. Dr. Littlechild, welcome to our gathering place. Welcome back to your university, the University of the Fraser Valley.
Well, thank you so much. What an honor to be back and to have been given such a great honor as an honorary doctorate. Something I had never expected in this lifetime. It always happened to somebody else, but not me, but this time it did. So I'm very honored to represent your university and to say I have my doctorate degree from here. And it's nice to be back and to share my art with you today and share from my heart my experience in a life's journey, a journey that is very familiar with many First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people of this country. So my art addresses social, political issues affecting First Nations. So I'm going to take you on the visual journey, and so it's sort of from the beginning of my career, more towards the latter part. And in that journey, I will describe each image. The images that I do are very poignant. They talk about issues that may be uncomfortable to some, maybe to many. Many will make a relationship. People in this room will have an understanding or might make a personal connection, whatever race or religion you may be. So bear with me as I go through this journey. It's interesting, some of the things are humorous, some are very serious, some of your emotions might be touched. I just say that after the presentation, if things do bother you, to find someone to call, just to check in to see how you're doing. So let's start. So, oh, and also I'd like to, I'm very honored to be here on Stalo territory. I'm very honored to be in the presence of this community as well, so thank you so much. So let's drop the lights. Okay. So, many, many years ago, as Mark mentioned, I was raised as what was called the 60s school. And I was raised in five different foster homes. And in that journey, I arrived at my fifth foster home, and my mother, who was a Dutch-Canadian, recognized that I had a talent. And it was a talent as a very young boy, and the fact that I could already draw when I arrived at their home, she noticed. And she noticed that it was a very natural gift in me. She was one of these mothers that was very determined to help a child to understand who they were, and she sought out art classes for me as a very young boy. And she would often have me sit at the table on Sunday afternoon after church and draw, and she sought out an art teacher to encourage my talent. So as a young boy, I would go for 50 cents a lesson in Edmonton, Alberta. After I did my paper route in this very old Victorian home. And the woman was a very aged lady who taught art to elderly women and young children. and she herself had been a university professor at the University of Alberta. And when contemporary modern art came to be, she just wasn't that fond of it. And so she eventually retired and thought that she would teach people out of her home. So I would go Wednesday after school, after my paper route, for art classes at 50 cents a lesson. This was a very long time ago. And we would all be down in her basement. It was kind of cold. Her house was quite beautiful, but the basement was all cement. And this odd room, this is where she taught art. And so there would all these children would be there, and stacks of different art supplies that we would use. It had a very interesting smell. The whole experience is quite vivid in my mind. I can still picture it today. Anyhow, she would give little lessons on how to draw and how to use pastels. We didn't paint. She didn't let the children paint. But anyway, every lesson we would learn something new. And what was interesting about Miss Ethel Field, she was a single woman, but what she liked to do is draw very realistic portraits of Inuit, Métis, and First Nations people. So her house was full of gorgeous, gorgeous portraits of these individuals that I would pass by as I would go downstairs for this art lesson. And I would sit there and think, how come she's not painting me? Anyway, that's another story. So anyway, went there for maybe a year or so, and then finally I didn't go. But towards the end of the lessons, there would be one boy in the class, and she'd always favor him. Gregory was his name. Oh, he was the best. And she'd always, you know, one of the teachers that compares one student better than the rest, I think it's so wrong. But she tended to do that. So I always wonder, what is Gregory doing today? So that, praise goes a long way, but anyway, that's what I was trying to say there. So this is my first image. It's interesting how I arrived at art school. I wasn't the most brilliant student. And I think in the day, you know, I think the education, the curriculum has changed a lot for creative individuals. And when I was going to school, often artistic individuals weren't always seen or recognized, and sometimes the potential wasn't really encouraged. But what happened was eventually I did go to a high school that had half a day of art classes. And I attended that, and then eventually I would progress on in life. And as a child, was told always that my art was very amazing. Many people would give me lots of compliments. My foster mother, as I mentioned, really nurtured the career that I have now, and I always thank her for that. But it was interesting, she would send all my drawings that I would do on Sunday afternoons to her relatives in Holland. So all these many years later on Facebook, I'm meeting these Dutch relatives who I've never met, but they still have my art, so I always find that very, very fascinating. How my mom was one of those moms who was very proud of the talent. So anyway, I ended up going on in life and really had no, I wasn't really going to be an artist, that's what I'm trying to say, and I had tried different things. I worked for the government, I tried different jobs. And then I eventually worked in Fort McLeod, Alberta at a detox center as I wanted to understand alcoholism and drug addiction. So I thought I'd throw myself right in the fire, so I worked there for about a year and a half. And then it was midnight shift and I'd always draw. I'd be drawing right during midnight shift. And my coworker, I worked with this Blackfoot woman for about a year and a half, and she had a very strong personality, and she would always say, George, you've got to go to art school. You've got to go to art school. No, that's just something I like to do. Oh, no. So eventually I took up the courage and I took my portfolio to Red Deer College. And I didn't enter the institution in the normal way. I arrived at the Department of Fine Arts, the Art and Design, and I arrived with my portfolio. And I went to the office and I approached the individual and I just said, my name is George. I'd like to come here to Red Deer College to attend your fine art program. I brought my portfolio, and he said, well, have you filled in the paperwork? Have you done all the administration things? And I said, oh no, sorry, I didn't. went through the side door. And luckily enough, that day he took the time to meet with me and sit down, and we went through my portfolio, and he looked at me with a very stern face, and he said, Well, you know, I really like what I see in this portfolio. There's some very strong work, and a lot of the things were First Nations imagery. And he says, but I hope in the program while you're here for 2 years, because I really think that we should accept you into this program based on what I see. And he says, but I hope you won't continue to draw Indians on horseback and bows and arrows, because all the other First Nations students that have attended this program have dropped out. So he instilled the fear in me, and so when I end this lecture today, you'll understand why I'm saying this. So for 2 years, while I was there, I did nothing about being First Nations or anything about my culture. And then I'll show you the piece in a little while, but there was one piece that was created that I actually did do, and that was the piece they kept for their collection. So you often wonder in those situations, you know, how the spirit or the individual rises above those comments, but what it did is instill the fear in me, and so I entered Red Deer College as a mature student, and I did amazingly well in that two-year program, and was the first First Nations student to graduate from that program, so I stuck it out, and so he instilled the fear of whatever in me, but I'm very happy and proud that I actually made it through that program. And I also, you know, I always encourage other First Nations and Inuit Métis people to do the same. And when you feel those weak moments or moments that don't always, the school, the situation doesn't really work for you. And I found that I would go to the counselor. And I would talk to the counselor about the environment, my feelings, what I was experiencing. And with that individual's help, I managed to stay within that institution and eventually go on to get my degree. So I arrived, so this is one of the images, we'll start talking about the artwork now, and so this is an image that I created when I went to the Nova Scotia School of Art and Design. But at Red Deer College, what I had traditionally done as an artist is I would draw very realistic things. I could draw each and every one in this room, your portrait, which would be very accurate and look very much like you. So when I arrived there and I was doing the work in my drawing class, I was suddenly getting Fs for work that people praised me for many years. So for me, it was, what was I not understanding? What was I not getting? And I had an instructor, Ian Page, and he one day said to me, George, you're coming from your mind. You need to come from your heart, from your soul, to experience your art in a totally different way. And thus this journey began. So you look at the work, it's somewhat naive, it's very simplistic, but what I began to realize that as a gift, the gift that I had is that I could speak about issues. Artists often are the individuals that will go to the front of the line, that will speak about issues that other people may not be able to do so, and often with their creativity, make very, very powerful statements. So I began to realize, and you have to imagine, this was many years ago in the 80s, and I really felt that I had this passion within me as I began to discover identity. So a lot of my work is about identity, about place, searching the journey, the play, how long it takes to get wherever you need to be, and those individuals that come into your path that help nurture you as you go along. So in this particular image, I felt it very important. And so I have the different faces, you have the three ships, and those are the three ships of Columbus and his arrival, I never say discovery, as we were here already. And so you see the Santa Maria, the Nina, the Pinta, and in Canada, and the people, of course, the Beothuk, they say were totally wiped out, and they were relatives of the Mi'kmaq people of the East Coast. And what about the other hundreds of thousands of First Nations people in South and North America that died of disease and mass murder? So for me as an artist, I felt I had to say something, because I felt that often First Nations people, especially in the school system, and I know that things have changed a lot, the curriculums have certainly changed. But in those days, there wasn't much known about First Nations people, and I really felt that it was my responsibility through my art to tell the story as I saw it. So, oh yes, I have the remote, sorry. Okay. So this is the piece I was talking about. So this was the only piece that I did at Red Deer College about my First Nations identity. and this was the piece they kept for their collection. So it's a serigraph. You see the different symbols. You see the symbols, the horses, the riders on the horse, and it would be tribal warfare. And our traditional enemy for the Cree were the Blackfoot. And you see the warriors returning back from warfare. Some of the, there's horses without riders, there's crosses that represent the death of warriors that would have died in battle. Returning to the home, you see the symbol of the teepee. But what's interesting with art and the process of art, which is already always fascinating, is you may notice there's sort of like a light fading feather that's coming from the top. You notice that? See on the top right, it looks like a print of a feather. And often in art, those processes do occur, and that for me is the magic, especially as an artist, that you can rely on your intuition to find the source, and sometimes information appears that you had no intent on creating. So for me, that's the beauty of art, the art process. Oops, we're going the wrong way. So here's a print that's very interesting. I like humor in my art. I growing up in foster care and very religious upbringing in Edmonton, Alberta, when I first met my First Nations relatives in what it was now known as Hobima, which is now known as Musquechis in Alberta. It's a large reserve. There's four reserves there, and now I think there's about 12,000 people live on the reserve. Anyway, what I found going back and finding my family was this experience, this gift of humor that we have as First Nations people, Métis people, is the fact that we can laugh at ourselves, laugh at situations. And it's all in good fun. It's not about bringing people down, but rather in some way building people up through humor. So we are very gifted at that. So in a way, some of my artwork is kind of slapstick. There's humor that's involved, and so you see this woman here. And often when I'm creating an artwork, the title comes to me, and often I'm quickly writing it down because as quick as it has arrived, it could quickly disappear. So this is Mrs. Smith sees her first teepee. She's just arrived from England, she's come onto the prairies, and there's the teepee. I'm not understanding that culture, looking at it, what is this? But at the same time, there's ignorance there. So for me, it was one way of sharing the story without clobbering people over the head with these facts. So I began to recreate and visualize these events that maybe lured you in. Like some people say, well, you're this great colorist. You have a real command of color. And as children, I'm sure some of you remember when we would start at school, we'd get the box of crayons and the Laurentian crayons. And the same colors were used in my art as a boy. It was always red, turquoise, yellow, black. Those were my favorite colors. And you'll notice that these colors still survive. But what I didn't know, and I think that there's blood memory, I believe there's blood memory in all of us. And in blood memory or connection to our ancestors, that there are things that come through us that we have no idea why. For many, many years of using this color, having the image of the horse in my work without ever, you know, living with my First Nations community and family, that I can remember living there and having these images within my art come forward, to me that is blood memory. To me, that's the ancestors speaking through the artist, and it comes out in the art. Oops. So here you see the horse, and so this particular image, so every painting that is created tells a part of the story. And so you see it's called Look Back to the Land That Was Once Yours, and you see this mythic warrior riding this gorgeous blue horse floating through the sky. And what you see in the background is an abstract cityscape. And it's talking about, as First Nations people, how we adapt to the environment around us. For those of us who were forced to live in the cities through circumstance and do not live in the communities, the reserve settings, for many of us that are urban First Nations people, this is our reality. So the story here is this warrior is floating through the sky, wanting to go back to traditional ways, knowing one's language, culture, and the sacred ceremonies, but in reality, and so that's the symbol of the teepee that is in front of the horse and rider, looking back, trying to regain that, but reality is that there's that modern cityscape and technology and the environment that we do adapt to and becomes part of our reality. But at the same time, trying to retain our sacred spirituality and language, if possible. I encourage every First Nations Métis Inuit person in this room to learn their language as best as you can. As we know, many languages, First Nations languages, are dying out in this country, in North America. My aunt, Cree, is one of the languages that is supposedly not to die out as quick as some of the others. And my aunt even says they speak Cree, my aunt and uncle, that are still alive, another uncle alive. And it's interesting, I'll say to my aunt, and she says, you know, I'll go to these meetings and there's a lot of words that I don't even understand. And of course, she went to residential school, and she says, the old Cree, the high Cree that the people spoke, those words are being lost. So now it's almost like a lazy Cree that is spoken. And I had never heard that. I always was under the assumption that the Cree language was intact, but like most languages and so many of our ceremonies have been so affected by the coming, the European, and of course the reserve setting, and then the residential school, now the 60s school. So my aunt, when she tells me these stories, I'm often, you know, here's this elder who speaks Cree, and I thought, well, it's not going to die out, but in a way, part of the language is already lost, and so the fact she speaks Cree, I mean, I think that's a wonderful thing, but we need to maintain who we are. And so I spoke about the reserve system, and so here, this image of, I like to do things in replication, and I often think there that the blood memory, the cultural memory that's within us, whether we have been taken away from our communities, have lost our culture, lost our language, that these things, as I mentioned earlier, do come through and really come through my art. And so I believe that my ancestors, like most of the women in the Cree culture, I mean, they embellished the traditional regalia that was worn, and I believe that somehow comes through me because I like to do things in pattern, and it seems very natural. So often, like the heads of these individuals in the cart, you know, very similar, so I like to do that. So these are different individuals that, of course, would have been placed onto the reserve system. It's not a reservation, that's the word reservation is an American word, and being forced to live off land, and so I have the word toys there. And so in those days of the time that I was creating this work, I would look for things that I would collage into the work that were tools or different ways that I could tell the story. And so on the cart, I've actually got beads that are embellished into the paint, which create a very rich texture. And so the individuals number 1, 2, 3, and 4 are like prisoners being forced onto these parcels of land. And what people don't often realize, it was an invisible fence around these pieces of land. And of course, there was people to jurisdict over you, which were called Indian agents. And the RCMP were there to help the Indian agent and the government control the First Nations people. So often, some of you who are of Aboriginal ancestry, you may start to do your genealogy and start to do research and find old records. And in those records, you might notice that your grandfather had to get permission from the Indian agent to leave the reserve and go to the town to see a doctor. And he had to be back at 4 o'clock. And if he wasn't back at 4 o'clock, the RCMP were sent to retrieve him to bring him back to the reserve. So it was very much a police state, and fear was very much a part of the situation of their realities of the ancestors. I've heard very few stories, and I know there are many, many more, but not knowing the Cree language fluently often is a hindrance, because those old traditional stories in all of our First Nations languages, when they're spoken and those stories are passed down, it has a totally different meaning, like any language, even if it's French. When you translate it into English, it does not sound the same, it does not carry the same energy. So, for me, telling the story and how important our languages are. And in those stories that I, the few stories that I do have, I'm very honored that I continue to carry those stories that I can tell my nephews and nieces. And one of those stories that I do have is of my great, 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 great grandmother, and her name was Kiskut, and it means cut nose. That was the name. And the story is that they were escaping from their enemy, the Blackfoot, and they came to the Red Deer River. And in crossing over the Red Deer River, her beautiful beaded moccasin fell off into the river and floated away. And somehow that story has survived in the family. So, you know, sometimes you, when you're First Nations and you don't have a connection to your history, your understanding of who you are, and no elders to share those stories with you, like our wonderful elder here today, you know, you're at a loss. But when you hear those remnants of that reality from a long time ago, that's where you get your connection and the importance of that connection to your community and to your identity. And once again, I'll say the word blood memory. So here again, you see individuals being transported, being forced onto reserves. So you see that there's two different women. It's actually my coca, my grandmother and her sister, and again, using them in replication. And so you see the cart, and you see it's the women are being pulled, and you see there the symbol of the cross. So I began to use different symbols to tell the story, very simplistic, kind of naive. And then you see the image of the horse, which is a very sacred animal in the Cree culture, the Plains cultures, and they're being allocated to live on the reserve. So you see the numbering system, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and of course that would have been the numbers that were given by the Indian agent, by the government of Canada, to identify and control, and that numbering system continued into the residential school, which I will continue on with in a few images later, and how the numbering system controlled. And that system continues today for all people on the planet. We all have wallets full of identification with a variety of numbers. Vote yes for self-government. So this is actually quite an old piece. So you see this stereotypic of what Europeans might think that all First Nations people might look like, with a very large aquiline nose, with the braided hair, the man wearing earrings. And you see this individual in a boxing arena, a wrestling arena. And I love when I go back to the reserve, here's my relatives, they love WWF wrestling, the big thing. And you see old auntie, she's 81, and she's sitting there in her chair, and uncle, all the kids, and the kids go down to Las Vegas to meet all these big wrestlers. It's really a big thing. To me it's humorous, but it's a big part of the community. So here's the individuals. So you see the warriors, they're small cutouts from these postcards. And then once again, you see the beadwork mixed with the paint. So then it says from a little package that I bought of cowboy and Indian figures. And so it says, cowboy and Indian figures. There we go. It says, so vote yes for self-government. So determining our future, I know that self-government is an implementation here in BC, and where the rest of Canada goes, I am not too sure. We are at, you know, we have made great advances as First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people, but we continue to struggle with the government, and especially with the Harper government, seems to be almost the worst at this stage, in my opinion. And that's just the thought. So, yes. So it's interesting, as I mentioned earlier, that my college professor had said I had to find the place where my art derived from, and created this simplistic approach to my art making. And I have many cousins. Anyone who's First Nations has many relatives. And I'll give you an example. So I had, my grandparents had 52 grandchildren. So a large extended family on my mother's side of the family. So anyway, one of my cousins, a cousin I had never met, and her sister was my friend. So my cousin says, oh, my sister came over the other day. I was on the phone with her, and her daughter was there, her daughter has special needs. And so the one sister said to the other sister, you know, I just don't get George's art. You know, I don't understand it. You know, he's trying to look at it. And the girl was funny. She says, Mom, you have no sense of humor. And I thought, kid got it. So what the mother, right? So what the mother is looking at, she's going, this looks like a cartoon. Like, I'm just not getting it. And, you know, like, bless her soul. And you know, like, I've heard that different times that my work looked simplistic in, like, a cartoon or whatever. It was funny one time. I was back on the reserve in Alberta, in Obima, now called Muscogee. And it was one of those moments where, if you've ever done a presentation and you're not sure who you're presenting to, you should have done your research. Well, do your research. Please do your research. So anyway, I didn't know that the group of students, these young students that I would be working with that day, were special needs and at-risk students. And this was several years ago before much was done. So this was a real tough crowd. Oh, they were tough. It was very hard to get them to understand what I was trying to teach them, and on, and this one little guy comes, my mom says you can't make art, you're not very good at it. And I'm like looking at this kid, and I'm thinking, oh, because she's looking at this stuff, and she's not understanding what I'm doing. So it's interesting, as I continue in this conversation, you'll understand that too. Okay, so anyway, I went to New York City in 1988, I was at Banff Center in that year. They took the students to New York to meet these very famous artists and went to their studios, experienced the big galleries, experienced the city. And it was probably one of the best experiences that I had ever endured as an artist, because the influence of that trip still resonates today. And so what I saw there were art pieces that would allow me and my spirit as an artist to fly and develop further. So you see the large skyscrapers, you see the small photograph of myself, you see the pink horse, Indian artist, visits New York, that's when we were called Indians still, 1988, that still existed. And so coming out of the horse's mouth, it says, wow. But if you turn it upside down, it says, Mom. So, you know, it's the play on words, finding humor, but it was a very important part of my experience. And why is the horse pink? So here's another part of the journey, and I don't know how many of you, like myself, were raised in foster care or were adopted, you may not be First Nations, and how that journey and how that experience does affect you greatly. Never feeling like you belong in any community, always looking for a place to belong, doing anything possible to have a sense of your own identity, looking in the mirror, seeing a face that doesn't look anything like the people that you live with, and realizing that your spirit was wanting to find the community of origin in order to fit in, to belong, and to take a deep breath and relax. For me, that was part of my journey, and I'm going to share that with you now. At the age of 17, I went to the Health and Social Development, and I told my foster mother what I was going to do. And I explained to her, and she was a loving, accepting mother. Without her, I would not be the person I am today. She said, no, that's fine, go ahead, I totally understand. She didn't really tell me anything about myself. She didn't share that with me. I didn't know if she didn't know or what the situation might have been. So I went to the office. I went for my meeting. The individual from the welfare department was sitting there. I don't know if it was a man or a woman. I can't. I was 17 years old. And I sat down and I said, I'd like to know who I am. Who am I? And in the next 10 minutes, I suddenly had a mother. I suddenly had a father. I had names of people I'd never heard of. But what I learned that day is that my father was a white man. I had no idea. I was raised being told I was First Nations, ridiculed, a lot of racism for being First Nations, and suddenly to discover that I had a Caucasian father. So also that day, what I learned, and this is the descriptions that were in the welfare report. So this is how they describe my First Nations mother. She was a short, stout Indian woman with an attractive face, but wore too much makeup. That was the description I got that day. They described my white father. He was tall and talkative and handsome. You know, and that's what they told me that day. And they didn't tell me much more. But what they did tell me was that I had an older half-brother, and he had timed out. And what that meant, he was over the age of 18, no longer a foster child. What I also learned that day is I had a full brother who was younger, and he was adopted. I also learned that day I had two full sisters. And they said to me, "You have a sister a year younger who's 16. She is a juvenile delinquent, and we do not recommend that you meet with her, and we will not provide you any information. However," this is a government worker telling a 17-year-old kid all this stuff, "however, you do have a younger sister, and she would like to meet her family. Would you like to meet her?" And I said, "Of course, I'd love to meet her." So anyway, the welfare worker, social worker said okay, and then about a month later there was a date that was arranged that I would meet my younger sister, who was 13. The evening before, I went out on a date with a girl that worked at the candy store just down from the Hudson's Bay, downtown Edmonton, and I had got to know her because I like sweets. So we became friends and then went on this date. And to this day, I do not remember the movie. It was just like a blur. And I'll tell you why. I had thought I was nervous about meeting the sister the next day for the very first time. So we were at the theater, and I guess you would call it a panic attack. I didn't know what that was, but I was having one. And I remember sitting there thinking, I just hope this movie ends quickly. And so the movie finally ended. I went around the corner with her across from the old McDonald Hotel, which is like the Hotel Vancouver, same style, same builder built it. And her bus came and she left. And I was so relieved that she left, because I was trying not to show her. I couldn't explain what I was feeling. I couldn't tell her. So I crossed the street in front of the McDonald Hotel, and my bus number is number 1, Highlands. And number 3 came, number 5 came, and I sat there. I'm like, and I was nervous. I just wanted to be in the safety of my home. So it seemed like 10 minutes had gone by, and I finally gave up. So I walked back in front of the theater, the Capitol Square Theater, that I had just come out of, where we had watched this movie. And another bus comes, no number 1, and suddenly there's no more buses, just quiet. So I'm standing about here, and there's no one there. It's just quiet, the car is going by. And then I'm like, I have never been able to wear a watch. They've always died when I wear a watch. I cannot wear a watch. So I didn't know what time it was. I sort of glanced back, and I saw a young lady standing there, kind of in the corner. Oh, I'll go and ask her. So I kind of go up to her. You can see she's not scared that this guy's coming towards her. I don't blame her. Being a single woman in that situation, I said, "Excuse me." So she's standing right here. I said, "Excuse me. Do you know what time it is?" And I'll be her. "Look around the corner." I thought, ooh, okay. So I walked around. It was almost midnight. So I stood away from her a minute. And I looked at her in a voice, and this feeling, my body went zzzz right from head to toe. And a man with a big voice said to me, "George, that's your sister." Ooh. And I looked at her and I went, "Ooh." So I pulled myself together, because I thought, if my bus came and her bus came, I will never know. So I got up the courage. And I went back towards her, and she looked very scared again. And I said, "Excuse me, Were you abandoned as a child? So here's her, and she says, yeah, how do you know that? I says, I think I'm your brother. So then we're standing there stunned, looking at each other, and I said, what do you say? And I said, look, did you know you had a family? And she said, yeah, I have one brother. And I said, no, you have three brothers and a sister. And I said, so this, and her name, well, I asked her name was Marilyn. This was a juvenile delinquent sister the welfare told me never to meet.
Oh.
So how did, you know? So I explained to her that tomorrow I was going to meet our younger sister for the first time. Would you like to meet her? And she said, look, I the bus came, I said, how will we find you? She said, I work downtown at this hotel. I'm a waitress. Come to my work tomorrow afternoon. I'll be there. So great. She was very beautiful, little about my height, thin, looked Aboriginal, very beautiful girl. And so off she went. So I get on the bus, like floating. And I get home, and my foster mother, bless her soul, she's very religious. And so they're in bed, mom and dad. So I get in the house, I walk down the hallway and knock, and mom goes, what? So I open the door and go, mom, guess what happened? And she says, what? And I said, do you remember that sister the welfare told me never to meet? She's the juvenile delinquent? Well, I found her on the street. So I tell her the story of being very religious and pragmatic. Oh, I prayed that would happen. And I'm not good for you. So anyway, the next day comes, right? So this is, I'm 17, 16 now, 13-year-old sister. So go to open the door, right? Nervous again. And there's a very tall woman, Caucasian, and a girl. And she's nothing like the girl of yesterday. Doesn't look anything like me. The sister I met looked more like me than this sister. She was kind of, I don't know, her nose was broke, her arm was shorter. It was quite awkward to her. So anyway, she came in, and I think it was somebody's birthday. So long story short, because I could go on and on, but we ended up going downtown after we had we had a nice little meeting together and went downtown to meet the other sister. And this foster mother, and she had many foster kids in this home, special needs, all types. And she took one look at this other sister, and she determined in a very short time and judged her very quickly and just said, oh, she's wearing so much makeup, she didn't like her immediately. And we were there maybe 5 minutes and left. And so that was that sort of meeting. So anyway, that's part of that journey. So we'll go to the next image. Oh, why is the horse pink? That's what I was sort of going on. You got to that whole other story. Why is the horse pink? Well, the horse is pink because what do you get when you have red, the red Indian, right, and the white man? Well, you get pink. So that's why the horse is pink. So here's the red horse in a sea of white horses. It's about being the other, being looked upon differently. The white horses have correct marks on them. The red horse has the arrow pointing down. And so it was that analogy, and it was my way, especially I had a book in 1993 that came out called This Land Is My Land. A publisher from San Francisco approached me and said, I love your art. And I said, I'd like you to write a book. And I said, well, I've never written a book. In my life, and I'm good at writing. And she said, no, I'd like you to write the book. So basically sat down with me, looked at my art, and then we came up with the images for the book, and then I wrote the stories. In hindsight now, I would have written it totally different because it was heavily edited by the editor. But it was my way, especially with this kind of artwork, to help inform educators about First Nations history and our history. And it was a tool also to teach children about First Nations. So it was very important for me to do that. And here we have the Mountie. We have the chief. And actually, in the original image of the postcard, the Mountie is taller than the chief. So in my painting, and this is the gift of being an artist, this is where you get to play and reinform images that are created. So you look at the teepee in front of the chief, you see the barrack of the RCMP individual. And in the middle there, these pieces were done about 1989. So all this work is older, by the way. And you see that black row, but what you can't see because the camera didn't pick it up, those are all, it's a row of mirrors. So when you would look at the art as the viewer, you would see a reflection of your own face within the mirror, and that was an opportunity to reflect upon what you knew about the situation at hand, and what these two individuals would have been conversing about, and what that part of Canadian history was and still somewhat is. So 1992, I didn't have an art show that year, and it was the quincentenary, the arrival of Columbus, and so I took different pieces from newspapers, Native Voices Must Be Heard, Columbus Invaded Americas, Next Life I'll Be White, Maybe Then I'll Be Trusted. So it was a very political time, a lot of people were reacting to the situation at hand, and so I created a body of art around those issues that I felt very important about. And many First Nations artists were doing the same as different individuals. We needed to speak about what had happened to us by the colonizers. And now it's so amazing that you hear this word of being decolonized. What does that mean? What does that look like? How do we decolonize ourselves? And so here's 1992, what was going on, the thoughts that were going on in the community and also within my mind as far as this situation was concerned. So here you have the three ships once again. You have the Taino individuals looking out, seeing the arrival of the three ships, Columbus. Why was the water gold? Because he was en route to India, looking for gold and riches. Why was the water red? Because of the mass murders and disease upon the First Peoples. It's interesting, what I love about giving presentations is the feedback that one receives from the audience. And the person said, you know, for me, the cross represented Columbus bringing Christianity to what is called the Americas today. And this person stood up and said, no, it's like a lobotomy, dulling the senses. And I thought, that's very appropriate, and very observative. Okay. Never again. So I think as individuals, as First Nations people, as all Canadians, I think we're being more and more informed about the plight of our First Nations, Inuit and Métis people in this country, as also in North America, as things shift and change and transform. And I don't know how many of you went to the Truth and Reconciliation Gathering. You want to raise your hands if you went? Okay, so several did. And how powerful those gatherings were. We managed to go to the one here in Vancouver, and I went to the one in Edmonton. And you can hear about the residential school through books, different individuals, but to hear someone actually testify, to tell their story, to sit there for several hours while individuals debriefed and told and shared their stories, as an individual like myself, who's a child of a residential school survivor that didn't survive that long, it was very hard to listen to be part of. But what I really felt, and the reconciliation which is still occurring within our country of Canada, but for me it was really important that those stories were told before they were forgotten, ignored, and erased. So the picture here, is my late mother when she was 9 years old at the Erskine Indian Residential School. And you look at her in her uniform, she's wearing her little tam, every girl in the picture is wearing the same outfit. You look at the hands of the girl beside her, touching her uniform, the girls behind. If you look at the hands, it was just really interesting to look at that photograph. And then I looked at my mother's hands, and she's, you know, I mean, obviously it's an awkward time. What was interesting, and the fortunate thing about the Ermiskin Indian Residential School, is there was a photographer, and he was a brother under the Oblates, in the Oblates Catholic Order. And what he would do is take hundreds and hundreds of pictures of the school kids. He would take pictures of weddings. He would take many, many, many pictures. And they were French Canadian, right? The nuns and the priests at the school. And he would come up and he'd say, "Oh, I'll make you look good." And then he would take this picture, right? So he had a relationship with the people. His name was Brother Guibert or Brother Gilbert. And so he documented the reality of the reserve. And as a result, we have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pictures. And as I mentioned, being raised in the 60s scoop, in which I'll describe, is the fact that for me, it was my way to identify or redefine who I was by going to archives and looking at photographs, trying to regain my sense of who I was. So in those photographs, what I would start to do is bring them back to the reserve in Hobima to different elders, because all these photographs had no names. And I would go to different elders, and I'd go to 10 elders, and if 6 said, "That's Mary," and the other 4 said, "That's Susan," I would put Mary on the back, and I'd say, "Perhaps Susan." So I would go around, right, getting the names of these individuals, these no-named individuals, and bring them back to the museum, because I felt that it was very important that these individuals were not forgotten. So here's another story. I could go on and on, but just thinking here. So I'll just tell you one more quick story how I found my family. So as I mentioned, when I went to the welfare department at 17, I learned about my father and mother. And then eventually moved to Calgary, Alberta, and I worked for a First Nations organization. And I had no idea where my mother was from. And so I had a lovely boss, and her name was Marie Crowshoe. And so she said, like all First Nations people, they always go, "Where are you from?" Right away, "Where are you from?" And then you say, "Oh, I'm from here." "Well, who's your grandmother?" "Oh, yeah, we're connected." That's to make this connection. And so what happened was, is I told her the last name. And so she was on the phone, and within a week, I was talking to a first cousin on the phone, right, for the very first time. And so I arranged a meeting with this individual that I would come to the reserve. I took the Greyhound bus from Calgary, went back to the reserve in Hobima, and then the town of Wetaskiwin in Alberta. And so I got off the bus, and everybody got off the bus. An hour went by, nobody was there to pick me up. I'd never been there in my life, right? No cell phone, we didn't have any, right? And I'm like, "Well, where is this guy?" And then I see this truck, right, a pickup truck, and there's this native guy sitting there with long braids. So, hour and a half, I'm standing there, hour and a half, he sat there. I'm like, "Well, why is he here?" So I went up to this truck, you know, knock on the window. He said, "Are you Richard?" He said, "Yeah." "Well, I'm George." Like, there was nothing said about the fact we both stood there. So I had this notion, you know, everybody has this, you're going to go back to your community, your home, and everyone's going to welcome you and just be so happy that you're back. So my little vision turned out to be nothing. It was nothing like that. So we go down these dirt roads, and right, we finally get to this house, and like, he doesn't talk to me, right? I'm like this crazy white guy, you know, all questions, oh, you know, and he doesn't say hardly a thing. It's like, wow. And we get to the house and get in the house, and there's this row of people, right, sitting on a couch, and you know, and then he said, "This is your uncle, this is my dad, this is your auntie." And nobody would look at me. And I was just like, what is going on here? Nobody seemed very excited that I was there, very stoic. But what I didn't know that in the Cree culture, you don't look at people in their eyes. You don't grab people and you don't hug them. So for me, it was a total shock. But it was the beginning of the relationship that has lasted till today. So that's how I found my family. Yeah. So not all Indians look alike. Good one. You get it? So it's an image of my great-grandmother Peggy. And so I just replicated her face, right? Because there's those stereotypes about other races, right? And so what do they look like, right? And so they can't describe because they think every person of that race looks similar. So it's a play on words and images. So I was asked to create a mural for the Irvinskin Secondary School on the reserve in Alberta. And so what I did is I created these large panels on the history of the Irvinskin Reserve, and this would have been the Treaty Payment Day. So every year, a $5 bill was given to every Treaty Indian, and it was always happened in the summertime. So you look at the image there, you'll see the RCMP, you probably see the mayor of the town of Pinoka, the men are drumming and singing. But what you see is those sticks with those pieces of paper, and those are $5 bills attached to sticks. And so they would have this ceremony that everybody would receive a $5 bill. So next time I go to Edmonton next summer, I've got to get my $5, because I haven't collected it for about 5 years, so it should be a $35 check. Right? But if you can imagine, in those days, $5 would mean a lot of money. Too bad they didn't consider the interest. So here again, you have another image. You have the Irvinskin Indian Residential School. You have different elder, her daughter. And I believe the woman, and we're still doing research, when you do your genealogy, it's a lot of work and talking to different elders. And when elders pass away, I always say another chapter of the book is gone. And so when that elder dies, the possibility of finding out who some of these people in these old photographs, potentially, that could be my great-great-great-great-grandmother, Madeline Opitaskowitz, which she bore five children, and one of them being my ancestor, and that would have been her daughter beside her, Isabel. So here's another, the modeling agent, I misspelled it. The modeling agent told me I was too ethnic looking to model. So these are old photographs of me. When I was young, a lot of people say, oh, you should be a model. So I'd go to these modeling agencies, right? The recommendation of different individuals. And they'd say these things that, oh, you're too ethnic looking. And back in those days, there was no people of color. If you looked in any magazine, or you looked in the catalog, your people weren't represented in those catalogs. But the beauty of that is that I have all these old photographs from that era. So I bet you didn't know art was this humorous. So this painting is called The Day Pope John Paul II Died. And I have this need to bring my mother back to her culture because of what happened to her residential school, to reclaim for her, because she passed away many, many years ago. As I mentioned earlier, she did survive the residential school, and this is a sad plight story of her. She had left the residential school, as all children, when they timed out, when you were 16, it was like your graduation, but not a graduation.
Honorable discharge.
Yes, honorable discharge, exactly. And so for her, she had seen what happened on the reserve, and she found her way to the city, and as I mentioned, had a union with the white man. So for me, I'm bringing her back to her culture with a sweat lodge in the back. You know, the sacred morning star is reclaiming what she would have lost and not had the ability to achieve. In the city, she had two relationships, had five children. All her children were lost to the welfare department, was a heavy alcoholic. Once her children were taken away, Her spirit must have died because it didn't take long for her to drink herself to death after prostituting. And for individuals, as First Nations people, you know, for non-First Nations people, to imagine, you know, if someone told you that this was your mother, or if you're adopted and you go and you're looking for this individual, and to expect sometimes perhaps the worst, then I guess that's the story of my family. So for me to, it's my way of trying to honor who she was, trying to give her back what she would have lost, had lost her dignity, had lost her respect, and perished on Skid Row in Edmonton. So the Truth and Reconciliation is a powerful tool, and I really hope that the government, after this, I think it's for another year, is there still?
Yeah.
And then I'm not sure will happen, but the funding needs to continue to heal our communities in order for generations to come, because the effects of the residential school are not over. They still live within our people, within the second and third generations. And what happened with the 60s scoop, if you don't know about it, was that the government took individuals forcibly, and not always forcibly. They looked for excuses to take First Nations children from their home environments for any reason, and children were actually abducted from their homes. This happened all across Canada. They say thousands and thousands of children were taken, and many children ended up living in the United States and other parts of the world. When my aunt, my late mother's sister, went to the welfare department in Edmonton asking what happened to her sister's children, us children, the government, the welfare worker told my aunt that, oh no, your sister's children were all adopted in the States. Meanwhile, we were still in Alberta, but we lost our tie. So they didn't find family members. If there was something wrong within that family unit, they didn't try to find people within their families to help raise those children. So the 60s scoop was a continuance of the residential school. And why do I say that? Because the parents that had gone to the residential school weren't taught how to raise their own children. The skills were not there. So the role models they had were these priests, these brothers and nuns. And for them, they had to find to raise children. I mean, they didn't know how. What they knew is what they were taught at the residential school. To hurt a child, to teach them everything they were taught. And so the 60s scoop is a continuance of that. And so the 60s scoop, well, it was an era that happened in the 60s, right? But it still continues today. If you look at the numbers of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis children that are in health and social development as foster children, the numbers are very, very high still. It hasn't ended. Picture of Christ, religion. I always say Christianity is a great thing, but what did it do to our people? As First Nations people, we suffered greatly as a result of Christianity. So here you see this young traditional woman. Where does she live? In the urban environment, the city setting. But learning her culture, retaining her identity, and knowing who she is. And that's the point of now. Young people of today, individuals that are going to this university, a lodge like this would have never existed 30, 40 years ago. I mean, you think about the education system, the support people that you have here at the university. And I honor you for having this institution and realizing the commitment to the Aboriginal community in this area, but all BC and all of Canada. Because without these special sacred places for students to attend, this creates the soul of the community. And what will happen in the future is that these students will give back. And these are those students learning who they are, discovering who they are, and being important role models in the future.
Yes, thanks.
So there's my father and mother and me. Residential school again. There's my grandparents are in that picture, right? It's a large image. So using digital art to also tell the story. Okay, so here. This is a doll. They used to make these. I don't know if anyone might have seen these dolls in their lifetime, but they were like, these are collectors now. These dolls are collector items. And there'd be a man, like looked like that with the blanket and beads, and his wife, and she was shorter, and she had a little papoose on her back. And they came in three sizes. You could buy them in three sets. So anyway, I found this doll at an antique store. But his eyes were to the side, right? Looking shifty. So with the computer, I put the eyes in the middle. Isn't it amazing technology? So this is First Nations Joe, and this, you know, I don't. You remember as a kid they'd go Indian Joe, like all men are Indian Joe. So First Nations Joe. Here he is. Okay. So here's Mixed Blood Joe, right? And so there's the doll, and there's this mannequin. This I used to photograph this guy. He used to live on Main Street. Oh, where are you? Come on. Hold on, he was one of the shows. Oh, there he is. And now, I know somebody might get offended, this is Second Nations Joe. Now, when you give a group a name like First Nations, come on. So this was a mannequin that used to live on Main and Broadway. And he would be outside the store, right, in different clothing outfits, and I'd go by and photograph him. And he had one leg missing and he was propped up, so I'd photograph him. So he eventually ended up in my art. See, as artists, you have this perception and reality that's a little different. So sadly, that building burned down and perished. So he burned with the storm. So anyway, I have a memory of that guy. So here's ancestry. So an old photograph of myself in the middle, my father James Price, my late mother Rachel Littlechild. Behind my mother is my Muslim, that means grandfather in Cree, with the cowboy hat, Edward Littlechild. He was a very gifted athlete, very tall. He was actually picked to play professional ball in the United States, but his wife, my grandmother Bella, who was beside him, had died, and they had 12 children. Behind Edward is my great-grandfather, Alexander Littlechild, and his wife, Jenny Cardinal. And her first husband was Charles Goyen. And how many of you heard of the Frog Lake Massacre in 1885? Yes. And there was different individuals that were murdered, and her husband was actually one of the men. He was a Métis carpenter, and he was shot that day, and she had two children with him. And then eventually she would meet Littlechild and marry, and then live in what was called Hobima, now Muscogee. And so then behind my grandmother, Bella, is my, there's my great-grandmother Peggy, and you saw her earlier, the woman I use for not all Indians look alike. And the man beside her, it's interesting, one day my uncle, when I was visiting back in Alberta, he says, I just want to tell you my grandfather's not my grandfather. I said, really? What do you mean, uncle? You know, he's not my grandfather. Well, who is your grandfather? Because I knew the man who I knew was his grandfather. So a whole story of, you know, suddenly I had a new great-grandfather, and so that's Antoine. And that's my great-grandfather. But this is an interesting story because my great-grandmother married her first cousin, the chief. And a long time ago in the Cree culture, you would marry your first cousin. But it would have to be that my mother's brother's daughter, I could marry her. But I could not marry my mother's sister's daughter. But in the Cree way, my uncle's daughter was my Nichimus, which means sweetheart, but I can't call my mother's sister's daughter, sweetheart, I called her cousin. So there was a reason for that. And so anyway, she did marry her first cousin, so I would have been related to myself three times. That's what I'm trying to say. And found out that by my uncle that he's not a relative. Anyway, so behind my father is my grandfather, John Mackenzie Price, came from New Brunswick. And his wife, Emma Dunn, and they were Irish-Scottish. My great-grandfather with the top hat, his name was Clareville Price, and he was 6'7", and he was a postmaster farmer. His wife, Charlotte Graves, and then behind my grandmother, Sarah, is Richard Dunn, and he was a carpenter, and his wife was Jessie Armstrong, and they were Scottish. She was a dressmaker, so that's the ancestry. So I started to explore images of First Nations and non-First Nations individuals together. I found this young girl's picture at an antique store, and I don't know what the situation was, but she looked kind of prissy and proper, and so I brought them together via the computer with this man, gorgeous photographs, actually both are really strong images, and his name is Augustine McEnoe, and he's seated and propped in that chair by the photographer. And whether that was his gun or not, often photographers would prop the First Nations individuals to look like in people they wanted them to look like, warlike, fierce. He's also my great-grandmother's first cousin. So the individual on the left is my grandfather's cousin from Los Angeles, Grace, and she has, that wouldn't be her home, but we brought that image into this digital photograph, and the woman here is Eva Pipestem, Cree woman, with the teepee behind, and there's the cross representing Christianity. Would these women in 1920 have tea together? What would they know about each other? What stereotypes, what understanding of realities would they have known about each other? So I created this body of work because I really felt it was important to have an understanding of these two cross-cultural images. There's my great-great-grandfather with the earrings and braids. It's an actual photograph of him beside the overseer of the town of Wetaskiwin, which meant the mayor. And so I put the Union Jack and then the idea of the cowboy Indian motif behind them. Once again, two different cultures. Why were they even photographed together? So my only idea is because he was a headman for the chief, and there must have been some kind of gathering, and that's why they're actually in that photograph together in 1898. My late mother at residential school, her first communion, my father as a boy, bringing them together. And so here we have mixed blood in traditional regalia. John Powell, who's in the audience, a good friend. And so that he is an artist. He makes button blankets, that's his own regalia. He also did the designs. I don't know how many of you saw the opening for the Olympics in Vancouver in 2010. The first hour, all those dancers, First Nations designs were gathered by John, making regalia, and all those designs were his. So also mixed race, so mixed, you know, whether you're mixed race is knowing your culture and how important that is to you. For your identity. Okay, one moment. Oh, sorry. Okay. Mixed blood is player. You got it. Okay, mother, Rachel Littlechild, age 18, 1947, 2 years after graduation from the Irvinskin Indian Residential School, Hobima, Alberta. So that's how she would have looked when she left, right? Look at the clothing, look at the hair. So, mother, Rachel Littlechild, age 18, 1947, clothed in traditional attire she would have worn had she not attended Indian residential school. So you have to look at what became of her. Oops. Wow. So strong, so moving on. So I'm going to read this to you. Strong as the Métis man, your brawn supplied the white man's fort in order to meet his voracious demands for beaver pelts, buffalo robes, and buffalo tongues. Outcast by your native brothers and the white man living on the outside fringes of society, traders, freighters, buffalo hunters who forage roam the land. Your spirit laughed, your body danced to the fiddle of the Red River jig.
Yeah.
And here's the other one, Métis, Opitaposan, that's Cree. And what it really means is half a human. So, interesting way to describe the Métis. So it says, roll amounts, people. Oh yeah, mixed breed, half breed, people of the buffalo hunt. Eking out a living and existence, your European and Indian blood melding, mixing, probing, forward, mixed race, Cree, Anishinaabe, Soto, French, Scottish, and English, unique
strong, and sometimes shunned, so numerous you became your own nation. Half, so this is the old modeling stuff. Breed. How I love to hate the word. So anybody who's mixed race, I mean, when Cher sang that song, Half Breed, I mean, the words just resonate very strongly. And it's a very derogatory word. So if somebody asks what I am today, I always say I'm biracial. So it's redefining who we are, and in language, as we know, is very important. Idle no more, right? Powerful, powerful movement. I remember Facebook is an amazing tool, and all these other, like Twitter. I remember we got an email that there was going to be a gathering at the park in Courtney. John and I went out there with drums, and how many were there?
Five.
Five. We all drunk. The newspaper came. So then, right, four gatherings later, and the momentum really grew. So that's what, so the tears out of the eyes are, of course, the water, right? Sacred water of the land. And the treatment of First Nations individuals, but it's about protecting Mother Earth. So we're almost done. So as I mentioned earlier, I was talking about when I went to art school and how they basically informed me that drawing realistic was probably not the best thing to do while I was attending that institution and had to develop my art style. But as I noticed as I get older and I've had many, many years in this career and creating that type of work, my work has actually started to become more and more realistic. And so you see the nun here with the girl from the residential school, right? It's more realistic. It looks more like the situation rather than an idea or an interpretation in a different style of art. So the last piece today, which is a little bit heavy, you see the priest. And so this was after attending the Truth and Reconciliation gathering here in Vancouver, hearing stories. And I remember the one story I heard by this very dignified, he was public, so it wasn't private. He spoke publicly and the camera was on him and such. And just, I know this man and I've seen him at potlatches and I've always admired him and his strength and his oration and how he speaks and carries himself. And to hear him talk about his sexual abuse at the school, it just left me speechless. And I went home, and this isn't him, and this isn't the priest or the brother. These are fictitious, but it was based on the story that he told me that I created this image. Now, I don't know how many of you heard about the project by Kerry Newman. He's an artist of his Kwakwaka'wakw, and I think stole it too, yes? And He created the witness blanket, which is at Capilano University right now. Anyway, I sent him this image, and it was really poignant because he came to interview me a couple Saturdays ago, and he had no idea. He chose this image to become part of the witness blanket. And where he put this drawing, not the original drawing, he put it on the door, and this door came from Alert Bay Residential School. It was the actual door, the actual handles on the door, everything was original, and it was the door that a lot of sexual abuse happened at the school, in the witness blanket. What he did is he took that image and he reproduced it and he put it onto the door and manipulated it a bit, and because of what happened behind that door was that. So he came to interview me, we're talking about the work and about art, about residential school, my story with my mother. And then it all came out and I said, the reason I created this because of the story your uncle told at the Truth and Reconciliation. So here we both were emotional because he was like very surprised, and here he had chosen that image to put on that door, the very door that was the room where these abuses were happening at the residential school. So I am going to close now. I mean, in my career, I produced approximately 700 different paintings or more. What I want to say is that when you have a gift, or you see a child with a gift, love, nurture that gift within you, or that child is an educator,
to share experiences, help that person grow, become who they need to be and they're intended to be by the Creator. And as I mentioned, I have this amazing foster mother. Without her, I would not be the person I am. In fact, yesterday we had a gathering, my foster family, my siblings, we had a great time together. And just knowing that when someone believes in you, it's certainly going to make a big effect in a person's life. And I want to thank you, Mark, and the staff here, and all the beautiful things you are doing for the students at this institution, because without you, it would be a very hard road. And so I honor you, and I just want to say education is very important. But we need to heal. We're still on a healing journey as First Nations people for generations to come. But I always say, you know, we need to tell our story. If we don't tell our story, somebody else will tell it for us. And so we all have a huge responsibility. And I'm thankful to the Creator each and every day for this gift I have in my art. And I always say art, closing with art, is my best friend, has never let me down, has brought me to places that I would have never gone. And now I have an honorary doctorate degree because of my art. So thank you so very much. Question. You know, I think being an artist, you sometimes have these illusions, or you create these grand scenarios. I think artists, creative people, have that ability, actors, singers, dancers, to transcend this world that you're in. I think that's why the arts is the gift that helped me survive, I'll be honest. How have they fared? Actually, two brothers have done extremely well. One is actually his master's. He works with First Nations people, married, has children, has quite a healthy lifestyle. Have another brother that married First Nations, and he has children. He's very proactive within the Native community. Who didn't fare well are my sisters. They did not do well at all. You know, I always say that in foster care, when you're in the hands of others, anything's possible, and especially girls. I mean, boys do. There is sexual abuse amongst boys too. But my sisters, one was in like 18 foster homes, sexually abused here and there. The other sister, the same thing. The one that I had met, how sadly she developed mental illness, had three children, has several grandchildren. She's doing okay. But you know, and I spent so many years finding my family. I encourage people to find their family, but you really have to expect sometimes the best and the worst. In finding my family, I think it was a bit of a pipe dream that I was going to help. Now my brothers and sisters, I actually met people that I actually looked like. I no longer, you know, I was raised by Dutch Canadians, I looked nothing like them. I find people I look like me, there were some similarities. So what I'm saying here, I spent many, many years looking for a family, and what I realized, you know, because now I only speak to one of them, like over all these years, is the family that you have is your friends, your close friends, and those ones who really love and support you, who are become your family. So yeah, it's a real tragedy, I think, with the residential school in the 60s scoop and how damaged so many people are. And we look at the Canadian penal system, and within that penal system, how many people are First Nations within that situation. And as I mentioned, I mean, it's so lovely to have such a wonderful elder here, but you know, we're still growing. I mean, and every individual in this room who's attending this institution, I honor you for getting this far, for getting here, continuing on in your journey, but be that positive role model always within your community, because without you, those youth that are coming up, we need to love and support them because they need to be stronger than us. So yes, thank you. Oh, sorry, yes.
Yeah, I. you come from a, a,
a bicultural kind of worldview. Could you elaborate a little bit about how that has made you who you are? To have a good understanding of both sides of who you are, how has that shaped your worldview as you see things moving forward?
Good point. Good question. Thank you. So being from two races, and you know, so interesting question, because you know, on one hand, I have all First Nations ancestors. Some were chiefs, some were leaders, some were medicine people. On the other hand, I have an ancestor who was a lieutenant in the French and Indian Wars, killing natives and French. On the other hand, I had an ancestor who had black slaves, right? So when you walk in the world, and only that day of that understanding that I had this Caucasian father, I had to reevaluate myself. I had to go and find, on this long journey of meeting my family on the reserve and then meeting my white family. And in meeting my white family, how shameful. You know, the story of my father would come to visit his wife, his sister, and my First Nations mother would stand outside the house, right, and was referred to as a squaw. You know, that's a reality, right? And so for me, you know, to look in the mirror, you know, when you're of a mixed ancestry and you walk down this road, you know, I think for many mixed race people, they tend to go to the First Nation side more than the white. That's what my experience has been. There's always some that will identify more with their Caucasian side, but most identify with their First Nations ancestry and their First Nations tribe. And often in artist gatherings, it's really interesting, but most artists that are very well known are mixed race. And I remember John and I went to this gathering here in Vancouver. And everybody was there, and so, you know, John, we were all asked to introduce ourselves. So I would have said I was Cree, right? But meanwhile, I'm half Irish, right? So I would never say I was half Irish. I'm Plains Cree. And so John says, I'm Quag Youth. What did you say that day?
My mom lived at Clatt, and on my father's side, I'm Irish, English, and Welsh.
And it was just like almost people started having permission to tell their true identity. So it's a totally different path, and sometimes when you're in First Nations environments, you feel like you're less. You know, that experience that you don't look, is my nose look native? Do I look native? You know, does my body look like native? You know, you go through, it's a lot more effort actually. I'll tell you that much, because you know, it's a lot of work. Or you know, you'll go to the reserve and your relatives will say, well, you look like a white man. And then I go to my white relatives and they say, oh, you look native. And it's very confusing. So I guess to answer your question is really you have to find that within your soul. And, you know, I think there's a bit of it that never leaves, that you continue on that journey in seeking your identity. And just finally, I'm Cree and I'm proud of that, but I'm also proud to be Irish. So it's just accepting yourself for the way you are, bottom line. So not being ashamed of it.
When my parents went to Hawaii, well, it must have been 30 years ago or more, one of the things that they found quite refreshing there is that when they would meet the Hawaiians, the Hawaiians would tell them the genealogy of who they were.
Right.
They would say, I'm Hawaiian and Portuguese and Japanese and whatever
their
heritage was, they would talk about it.
Yeah.
And which was, I think, very important for my mother, who was half, British, Scottish, for her to give herself permission to talk about that part of herself, too.
And what freedom she would have had, right? Because it's almost like you're denying half of who you are by not telling others.
Yeah. So. Well, she grew up in a community where she didn't see herself. There was no mirrors in her house. So she always saw herself as a brown baby playing with other brown kids.
Right.
And it was a shock when she realized that she saw some pictures of herself when she was younger, and she said, who's that kid? That's you.
Right. So very confusing in a way.
Well, I don't think she was never really confused. She just was surprised.
Oh, okay, surprised.
Because that was she just didn't see herself when she was a little boy.
Yeah. It's a good story. Thank you.
When I first got my Indian status about 15 years ago, I would say I was in my 50s at that time. And of course, both on my mother's side and my father's side, there's a long line of mixed blood, okay? And I was sharing, you know, hey, I finally got my status, you know, to this fellow. And he said, oh, he said, I just got back from Arizona and I saw this guy with a t-shirt on. And it said, on the t-shirt, it said, I know I have some white blood in me. I just can't prove it.
It's a great story. A few stories I haven't.
Yes. Thank you.
Well, you know, when I established this lecture series, the intent was to bring in people who would educate us, who would inspire us, who would provoke us, who would make us laugh, make us cry. And George, you have captured it all. I thank you on behalf of one of your, another family, or University of the Fraser Valley family. I thank you for not only for the contributions you're making to the people of our family here, and I know you're going to be around for another day meeting with students and faculty and staff, but I'm sure I speak for all of us when I thank you for the way you're changing the lives of so many people well beyond these borders. Deeply appreciate it. Thank you. And perhaps a little into the afternoon. I'm not sure what sort of evil schedule they've got planned for you. Thank you all for joining us this evening. Some of us are going off for dinner. So.
Asiam. I always appreciate when our president shares and he always takes direction from me, so I know that he's okay with me walking out and talking to you. And you recall at the beginning, our friend George asked us to remember that some of the things that he was going to talk to us about were going to touch our heart, and that maybe they were going to make us cry a little bit, or they might make us not feel so good when we go home tonight. To remember to phone somebody, check in, make sure that you feel okay. And one of the ways that I know to do that, my Uncle Harold Belmont, he said when we talk about these things, he said one of the things that we do after is take care of ourselves. And we have to do that in a good way. I'm gonna ask my cousin to sing a song for us, not because what we talked about is bad, not because we shouldn't have talked about it, we shouldn't have listened to what it was that we heard, but because we have to let go of those things that don't belong to us. We have to look after ourselves in a good way, and that's what our elder can do with the song. And his name, Tiedlem's Bath, says that he can sing, and I can ask him to do this, and he knows I'll pay him later. Yeah. I'll give you an IOU. But I'm really grateful that he's here and he has a drum. And so I'm going to ask each and every one of you to let him lift this up off of you and have good feelings and happiness as you leave this afternoon, and that you don't carry this with you because these burdens have already been carried. Setzel A. Heitzpassiam.
Oh, CMCIA. The song that I'm going to sing belongs to the university.
Yes.
It's a song that we are blessed with by Shahid Latul, Victor Bisayo from Tawali, just over here, a little Stalo community just across the river here. And he got this song because my uncle asked him to get a song for the university because we were building this gathering hall here. That is a facsimile of our longhouse. And so at the longhouses, every longhouse has a song to welcome the people, to bless the food, to sing at celebrations. So this song belongs to the university, and we invite Dr. Mark Everett to learn this song, along with Peter Miller, Eric. But we so I'll sing this song.
It's a really upbeat song, so it's a song to once again honor him, to bring out the truth, to bring out what he did today.
Whoa!